Hi everyone, it's Emmanuel here. Jesus, when he was on earth, made a lot of shocking statements, okay? And one of these shocking statements, I'm going to paraphrase for you right now, and then we're going to read the actual account. And one of these statements that he made was this. Listen, everyone. Did you know, all of you religious leaders, okay, you listen up. Because the prostitutes, okay, and the corrupt politicians will enter the kingdom of heaven before you enter them, all of you religious leaders. That's basically what he said. Prostitutes and corrupt politicians, businessmen will enter the kingdom of heaven before these quote-unquote religious leaders and pastors and evangelists and all these people. Well, why? Why did Jesus say that? Okay, in Matthew chapter 21, you read this account. The words of Jesus goes like this. Matthew chapter 21, starting in verse 31. In the middle of it, Jesus said, "Assuredly, I say to you, that tax collectors and harlots enter the kingdom of God before you." And he was talking to the Pharisees, okay, of the time, the religious leaders of the time. "For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But tax collectors and harlots believed him, and when you saw it, you did not afterward relent and believe him." Now, if you read the gospel accounts, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you will see, especially in the gospel of John, okay, I really encourage you to, you know, see the movie, the gospel of John, okay, there's this DVD, the gospel of John. When you see it in play, you see the dialogue between Jesus and the religious leaders of the time, it really gives the picture of how the religious leaders of that time really didn't get it. They didn't really get it. They thought they had it. They're like, you know, we hold to the law of Moses. You know, our Father is God. But Jesus says, I know you don't have the love of God in you because you have the love of men in you. If you say you have the law of Moses, you say you believe in the law of Moses? No, you don't. You know, because if you believe in the law of Moses, you believe in me. Because Moses wrote about me. And yet you are not willing to come to believe me and have life. And so what is the problem here? Okay, why did Jesus make this statement? Because first of all, let me just say this, okay? Jesus is not advocating sexual immorality, saying, oh, everyone, let's just commit all the sexual immorality, whether you're a prostitute, whether you commit homosexuality, whether you have sex before marriage and pornography and all this stuff, oh, hey, no worries, everyone enter heaven. That's not what he's saying, okay? You gotta read afterwards. He said to the Pharisees, because afterward you did not relent and believe him, because John the Baptist came in a way of righteousness. Okay? And these harlots and these tax collectors, some of them believed. They repented. Because what do we know about John the Baptist? When we think about John the Baptist, who is this guy? Well, the Bible tells us he is the person who was crying out in the wilderness, right? Eating locusts and honey. Okay? And he's the one that prepares the way of the Lord. And his message was what? Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. The exact same words that Jesus said when he started preaching. Okay? That's why if you look at the Gospels, okay, you understand that the Gospel of Jesus Christ is always about repentance. Not just about this quote-unquote belief. Just believe God. Everybody can believe God. Okay? But not everybody will repent. Okay, you got to understand that. That's what James chapter 2 talks about. Everybody can say they believe God. Even demons believe God. James chapter 2. But demons not saved because they don't repent. They don't turn away from their sins. Just like today. Many people claim, oh, I believe God. Yet they live like the world. They continue to sin. They don't have a love of God. They don't have a love of the Word of God. Because their lifestyle shows that they don't love God. Just like what Jesus said in the entire Gospels. Even though these religious leaders, pastors, you know, of that time, okay, bishops, priests, they were all deemed to be the religious leaders of the time. In Matthew 23, Jesus says, all these people come to them, you know, they're like, Rabbi, Rabbi, teacher, teacher. And they're like, oh yes, that's what I am. That's what I am. I am Rabbi. you know, I'm the teacher, you know, and they sit at the seats, you know, the best seats in the feasts, in the synagogues, you know, kind of like the seat, okay. You know, high up there, you know. Now, let me also say this. I am not against, you know, spiritual leaders. In fact, we need godly, righteous spiritual leaders today in the church. Those who truly love Jesus, there is an order in the church. Okay, I am not, you know, I know people out there, they've got really burned by church traditions and leaderships, and so now they do 180 degree, you know, kind of rebel against it and think that, oh, you know, forget about all the, you know, all the church and order and all the organization and all that stuff. You know, it's free for all. Everybody's got to do everything. Okay, I'm saying, guys, there is an order in the church. Ephesians talk about this. Christ is the head of the church. Okay, and you know, he loves the church and gave himself for it. So there's order, okay? And he puts a fivefold office, you know, apostles, prophets, you know, evangelists, teachers, and pastors. You know, like, they're there, okay? But the role of the leaders, the spiritual leaders, is not to just exert this power. Oh, I am Mr. Powerful. Like the, you know, religious leaders, that's not what it's for. The Bible tells us that they're for equipping Christians, equipping believers so that they can also do the ministry. Okay? We should have leaders like that. We should have religious leaders like that who have a pure conscience, pure motive for God and for his kingdom. It's not about our earthly ministry. It's not about our earthly organization, whatever it is. That's the part that the religious leaders, the Pharisees, Sadducees, and the lawyers, that's what they missed, because they did not relent and believe. Okay, they did not heed to the message of repentance, which John the Baptist said. And that's why Jesus said, harlots and prostitutes and tax collectors back in the time were not well respected, socially outcast. Okay, that's why I compared them to be, you know, corrupted politicians or, you know, like crooked businessmen. Jesus says when they repent and believe, they will enter the kingdom of heaven before the religious leaders. Why? Because those of us who've grown up in the church, like me, I've grown up in the church. You know, I went to church on Sundays, and you can look at my testimonies and my other videos and on my website. We've heard so much about the spiritual terms. You know, I you will not realize how much you are, quote unquote, immersed in this church environment until you start talking to unbelievers. Recently, I'm talking to this seeker, and you know, I start using these terms. I didn't realize, oh yeah, I went to this fellowship. What's fellowship? You know, it's like, oh yeah, that's when we have communion in church. What's communion? Oh, okay, communion is where we do this. It's also called the Eucharist, and you can explain, you know. And then I was baptized in this year. What's baptized? You know, terms that we use. People have no idea what it's about because we're in this environment. And this is the danger, okay? Those of us who are quote unquote, if you and I think, okay, now if you and I have grown in a church and we think that we got it, okay, this is the exact time that we need to examine our lives to make sure if we really got it. Because the religious leaders of the time, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the lawyers, lawyers, not meaning like legal court, lawyers back then, those who are very familiar with the law of Moses, okay, that's what they're called, okay, these quote-unquote spiritual leaders, okay, that equates to the pastors, you know, or bishops, priests today, they thought they had it, and it doesn't have to be just leaders, it could be people who have been in the church. Why am I talking about this? Because it's so important that sometimes we think, we're so quote-unquote spiritually advanced, we're so spiritually minded. Oh, I've been in church 30 years, I heard this 40 years, 50 years, that we miss the point, that we miss the gospel, that we miss the kingdom of heaven. Is that possible? You sure well be sure that it's possible. Because Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5, verse 20, he says, unless your righteousness exceed that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. Meaning that the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, even though they thought it was very high, even though they thought they're all up there, they're keeping the law of Moses, if you study the history of the Pharisee movement, they were a holiness movement. They wanted to please God. They wanted to do what's right in the eyes of God. But yet, what did Jesus say to them? They missed it. Read Matthew 23. They completely missed it. That's why it's important for you and I, especially those of us who consider ourselves to be rather well-versed in the Bible, or that we've been to church a long time, may you remember, God gives grace to the humble, but He resists the proud. Our attitude to, you know, for the kingdom of God, for the gospel, is that, God, I just pray that You continue to change me, help me be humble. Okay, I don't want to, whenever you find yourself judging another person, I have to do this repeatedly. I make so many judgments. I don't know why, I just have to repent many times when I just pass a judgment on someone and later I found out, man, that was completely wrong. Or sometimes I just make a judgment, immediately have to repent because I know it was wrong. Okay? You got to realize, Jesus says, when the disciples were arguing who's the greatest in the kingdom of heaven, what did Jesus do? He took a little child into His hand, telling these disciples, listen, unless you become converted and become like a little child like this, you're not going to enter the kingdom of heaven. And those of you who want to be the first, let Him be the servant of all. And what did Jesus do? For the Son of Man, even the Son of Man, He's talking about Himself, Jesus, did not even come to be served, but to serve. Do you understand? The gospel of the kingdom of heaven is not about spiritual status, power, fame, recognition. It's about a broken heart, a broken, contrite spirit before God, and walking in repentance. Because this is the message of the kingdom of God. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. That's why Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7, verse 21 to 23, on that day, on the day of judgment, many will call Him Lord, Lord, and say, I've done many mighty miracles, wonderful works for God, quote unquote God. And yet Jesus will declare to them, I never know you, because you are workers of iniquity. We don't want to be that. We want to be those who, like what Jesus says, relent and believe. Repent of our sins, turn away from them, and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. Our tradition, our years in the church, our memorization of the Bible means nothing if our lives are not changed, if we're not truly born again. I've talked to an atheist who read the Bible 3 times, okay? How many Christians have read the Bible 3 times in entirety? I haven't even done it. And I was put to shame when I was talking to this atheist. Listen, I read the Bible 3 times and yet I still believe, and he's talking about this New Age stuff. You know, I'm praying for him, talking to him. Just because we have a lot of knowledge and study the scripture, even Jesus said in John chapter 5, verse 39 to 40, He says to the Pharisees again, you study the scriptures diligently. You study them very diligently because you think that in these scriptures have eternal life. But He says, but you fail to come to Me and have life. So Jesus, you can actually miss it. You can study this book, you know, do your quote-unquote 30-minute devos every day, and yet completely miss the kingdom of God. Because you think that just by reading the Word of God, doing good, okay, and feeling right, okay, it's not about that. Jesus is talking about over and over again, it's not about how we think we're good in our own eyes and in other people's eyes. The only way that we're going to be good is if we repent, turn away from our sin. God, I don't want to live my old life anymore. And I trust in You today. Change me, transform me by the power of Your Holy Spirit, not on my own. And I just want to see that I'm bearing fruit in my life. And when you see that, that's when you experience a true born-again experience. So may you and I be remembered, be reminded of the fact that it's not about our spiritual affiliations, not about our status, whatever it is. It is about our heart, a heart that is truly broken, contrite before God, humble, seeking to please God in our very motives, not just in what we do, but in why are we doing it? What's our motive? And when our heart and conscience and motives are pure before God, our lives will act accordingly. May the scripture encourage you and I to examine our lives before the coming of our King. I bless you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. May you and I and our families walk on this narrow path and fight the good fight of faith and keep our faith steadfast till the end until Jesus comes back. God bless you.
Oh God, stamp eternity on my eyeballs. But you know, if God should stamp eternity or even judgment on our eyeballs, or if you like, on the fleshy table of our hearts, I'm quite convinced we'd be a very, very different tribe of people, God's people in the world today. We live too much in time, we're too earthbound. We see as other men see, we think as other men think. We invest our time as the world invests it, we invest our money. We're supposed to be a different breed of people. I believe that the Church of Jesus Christ needs a new revelation of the majesty of God. They're all going to stand one day. Can you imagine it? At the judgment seat of Christ, to give an account for the deeds done in the body. This is what? This is the King of Kings. And he's the Judge of Judges. And it's the tribunal of tribunals. And there's no court of appeal after it. The verdict is final. Listen, when you see Jesus, you're not going up and say, hey buddy, I'm glad you died for me. When you see Jesus, you'll be almost paralyzed with fear unless you have a glorified body and a glorified mind. You say, well, Mr. Raynor, I won't be in serious trouble because, you know, I don't have a good memory. Well, I'll tell you what, you'll have one that day. In Malachi, it says that God has a book of remembrance. And I think it will do you good before you go to bed every night this week to ask God, what did you put in your book today for my life? Did you get up this morning and thank God you were pure? Did you thank him that devilish fever you used to have for sniffing cocaine or drugs or something, that he broke the fetter of it? Are you really glad you're not a prostitute now? You're going to be a part of the bride of the Lamb? Are you glad he's removed from your heart covetousness and bad temper and all those creepy, horrible things that used to master you? The most shattering thought I've ever had is my personal accountability to God one day. We're not going to be judged just because of what we've done. We're going to be judged for why we did it. Not for the action, for the motive. What motivated your giving? Why? What's the motive behind it? It doesn't just take your sins, it takes yourself. It takes the government of your life. And it's not only true that we live in a world of bankrupt politics, we live in a world, and this is the most tragic of all, of a bankrupt church. When in God's name is the church going to open her heart again and open her mind again and see again? Can God forgive every sin I've ever committed? I said he sure can. That is, if you repent of your sin and you plead for the blood of Christ and you ask for mercy, that tender Christ who went about doing good and he kissed little babies and blessed people, there's nothing more beautiful than a little lamb. There's nothing more terrible than the wrath of the Lamb. God should bring every work into judgment with every secret thing. The dead, small and great, are going to stand before God in that awesome day. But say, am I just a showman? What's my secret life like? For God has not merely given us Jesus Christ, he's given us all things. And because there isn't enough joy in the house of God, we need entertainment. Because entertainment is the devil's substitute for joy. I think before we point the finger at the world, we better turn to the church and say, look, we better all get sackcloth and ashes and humble ourselves and say, Almighty God. When I see the church in the New Testament, they didn't have stately buildings. They didn't have paid evangelists. They didn't have a lot of money. They didn't have organization. They just couldn't get on TV and beg. But I'll tell you what they did. They turned the world upside down. And I'm embarrassed to be part of the Church of Jesus today, because I believe it's an embarrassment to a holy God. Most of our joy is clapping our hands and having a good time, and then afterwards we're talking all the drivel of the world. Oh, to be lost in him, to be consumed in him. You get so near to the heart of God that you share his grief over a world and over a backslidden church that we have today. Because if you're going to get mature in God, all the dwarfs around you will criticize and sneer at you and say you're trying to be holier than the rest of us, huh? You discover this, the men who have been most heroic for God have been the men with the greatest devotional life. The only thing that will tie me in victory continually through the blood of Christ is my personal devotion to him, the Son of God. my adoration, that I give him my tribute every day. It's more than my service. It's more than giving my money. That I love him and I adore him and I magnify him. I take him, as it were, by the feet. Do you know why the world is poor and thick outside? Because we really don't know how to pray, that's why. I've said it many times, I say it again this morning, that no man is greater than his prayer life. Let me live with a man a while and share his prayer life, and I'll tell you how tall I think he is, or how majestic I think he is in God. It's going to be an awesome day. You see, there's no possibility of any rehearsal. And what? There's no possibility of any repetition. Because again, this is the final judgment. I think again of a statement Dr. Tozer made to me once. He said, Len, you know what? He said, we'll hardly get our feet out of time into eternity and gaze on eternity before we bow our heads in shame and humiliation and say, my God, look at all the riches there were in Jesus Christ, and I've come to the judgment seat almost a pauper. Master, forgive and inspire us anew. Banish our worldliness. Help us to ever live with eternity's values in view. Said that great man who birthed that revival, God, stamp eternity on my eyeball. You know, if we can't live as a different breed of people on this earth, we've no right to live here. And if we get back to a people who are really baptized with obedience, submissive to the total will of God, not concerned about human opinion, not asking for more to spend prodigally on ourselves, but say, oh God, I want this life of mine adjusting so I, when I stand in your awesome presence, as James says, we shall not be ashamed at his appearing.